Hi, welcome to the Academy's 28th week of Toolbox Tuesday. Wow, the scene of this world is changing. We are entering into historical prophetic times. So the question arises, how can we carry on as men and grow mighty? How do we prove ourselves to be a prepared people? How do we equip ourselves with weapons of the light? How do we remain faithfully intact through these things that are quickly approaching? The Academy is proactive in seeking solutions and practical application of truth. So, to first put up a defense, it's important to consider what our battle is. Ephesians 6, verse 12 tells us we have a wrestling, not against blood and flesh, but against the governments, against the authorities, against the world rulers of this darkness, against the wicked spirit forces in the heavenly places. So again, what can we do? How can we prepare ourselves for this prophetic time that we are living in? We can learn so much from God's faithful people in the past. So this is where we are going to begin on the subject. We shall start by contemplating the faithful conduct of others, that we can obey the admonition to be imitating their faith. Now, we know we are to be respectable, law-abiding people. As Romans chapter 13, verse 1 tells us, let every soul be in subjection to the superior authorities. Here Paul is talking about governments and kingdoms of the earth, that we are to be reasonably law-abiding citizens. Verse 2 goes on to say, therefore he who opposes the authority has taken a stand against God. Now wait a minute. How does this jive with Ephesians' statement at Ephesians 6:12 that says we have a wrestling with these very authorities? Well, it's on this basis, the basis of being obedient and faithful to the true God and our Savior Jesus, that is allowing these present authorities to stand. For there is no authority except by God. The existing authorities stand placed in their relative positions by God. Yes, the basis of our respect for authorities is founded on the basis of our faithfulness and respect for the Most High God and Christ, and out of an obedient heart for divine godly law, knowing that universal law and the law handed down to us by God trumps all other law, so that we have no necessity to disobey law that is not against God, nor obey law that is against or opposed to the law that God gives. Our Heavenly Father God is, after all, the universal sovereign, and he is our authority. Take, for example, the apostles of Christ. Were they lawful people? Yes. Did they pay their taxes? Yes, they did. Did they rise up and revolt against the political or religious systems of their day? No. Did they view Jesus as their king and speak truth of God even when kings of the earth prohibited and outlawed it? Yes, indeed they did. Let's turn to an example of such. In the apostles' day, speaking about Jesus and the salvation belonging to him was outlawed. And even though the apostles were law-abiding to Caesar's law, the laws of the land, they never allowed man's law to override God's law. Let's take a look at an example of this. At the book of Acts, the fifth chapter, here we enter a scene where the apostles were busy doing what Jesus commanded them. What did Jesus command his followers? Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And at Matthew chapter 10, verse 8, Jesus ordered, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the leopards, drive out demons. You receive free, give free. Now the apostles were busy doing all these things that Christ ordered, even though it was banned by man's law and the religious leaders on earth. Acts chapter 5, starting at verse 17. But the high priest and all those with him, the then existing sect of the Sadducees, rose and became filled with jealousy. And they laid hands upon the apostles and put them in the public place of custody. Here the apostles were arrested for doing what Jesus commanded. Upon their release, they continued without let up, doing what they were instructed in spirit. Looking now at verse 20 and 21, be on your way, and having taken a stand in the temple, keep on speaking to the people. In verse 21, after hearing this, they entered into the temple at daybreak and began to teach. Now, when the high priest and those with him arrived and saw the apostles again teaching, they had the captain and his officers bring the apostles back into custody. Let's see the scene. So they brought them, stood them in the Sanhedrin hall, and the high priest questioned them, saying, we positively ordered you not to keep teaching upon the basis of this name, and yet look, you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching. Well, now what? How do the apostles reply? Let's contemplate their conduct. Peter replies at verse 29. And answer Peter and the other apostles said, we must obey God as ruler rather than men. Are we with them? Are we respectable, peaceable, law-abiding citizens? Are we, however, so rooted in our faithfulness to God and Christ that God's law reigns supreme in our hearts and we find no necessity or obligation to follow law that is in direct opposition to the law of God and the way of Christ Jesus our Lord? What we just considered with the apostles is an example of our God-given right to choose and serve God or our ministry being outlawed and prohibited. We, in contemplating the apostles' conduct in such scenarios, allows us to imitate their faith. We, too, obey God as ruler rather than men. Prophecy speaks of days coming where our worship will be outlawed. And speaking of the wild beast, Revelation, the 13th chapter, mentions war. And there was granted it to wage war with the holy ones and conquer them. And authority was given it over every tribe and tongue and nation. Suppose for an instant that not only speaking of spiritual truth is prohibited, but also congregating with fellow believers, or having Bibles or Bible literature of any kind, or what if it was all outlawed and reason for arrest? Or how about any kind of expression of religion or faith is deemed criminal? Have we stored up the word of God in our hearts? Have we branded it into our minds? Have we embossed it in our souls? Does the word of God exist in us? Is it alive with spirit, facilitating our lifeline to God? It needs to be, if we desire to come off completely victorious in all things through Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's move on now and turn our attention to an example where worship was banned. We're now going to contemplate the faith of Daniel. At Daniel chapter 6, we read about worldly advisors seeking something to catch Daniel in. Now, being a person of the true God, Daniel was respectable, he was peaceable, he was law-abiding. But the worldly and spiritual advisors of Daniel's day knew he was a man of godly devotion and knew that in setting laws against God's laws would be the only way they would be able to catch him and cause him trouble. In Daniel's case, how did he respond when the law went through? Whoever makes a petition to any god or man for 30 days except to you, O king, should be thrown to the lion's pit. Daniel chapter 6, verse 9 tells us how Daniel responded. Even three times in a day, he was kneeling on his knees and praying and offering praise before his God, as he had been doing prior to this. Yes, Daniel did not let man's law stop him from praying and worshiping his God. He continued petitioning and imploring favor before God, even though it was against the law of the land, and he would be subject to death by being pitched into the lion's den, which did happen in Daniel's case. We're all familiar with the account of Daniel's in the lion's pit. But the true God is faithful to those acting loyally. Daniel makes a reply from what was to be his grave. My own God sent his angel and shut the mouth of the lions, and they have not brought me to ruin. And James, at chapter 1, verse 12, James joins in on the triumphant victory of the faithful when he says, blessed, happy, spiritually prosperous, favored by God, is the man who is steadfast under trial and perseveres when tempted. For he has passed the test and been approved. He will receive the victor's crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Can you imagine God addressing you as favorable or highly desirable, like the angel Gabriel addressed Daniel? Different account, but wow, certainly gives us something to aim for, doesn't it? So, with Daniel, we see an example of obeying God's law and being faithful in worship when worship is banned or law is passed that forbids it. Daniel too had faith that we can imitate. Daniel was a man of faith that obeyed God as ruler rather than men. What about law being passed that mandates that you must do something that is outlawed by God? When law of man mandates a law that is in direct opposition to the law of God, then what? Let's look to Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael, or better known as their Babylonian names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Daniel chapter 3, we read about the king of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, made an image of gold, the height of which was 60 cubits. 90 feet tall, and the breadth, which was 6 cubits, 9 feet wide, and set it up in the city, and placed an order throughout the land that everyone, upon hearing the tribute music, must fall down and worship the image of gold. And whoever does not fall down and worship will at the same moment be thrown into the burning fiery furnace. So, how did the three faithful men of the true God respond to the order of idolatry? In Daniel chapter 3, verse 12, we read, there exist certain Jews whom you appointed over the administration of the jurisdictional district of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These three able-bodied men have paid no regard to you, O king. They are not serving your own gods, and the image of gold that you have set up, they are not worshiping. And Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18, we read Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's reply when they were arrested and brought in before the king to receive their sentence and pitched into the fiery furnace alive. Here they reply and rest their defense. Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we are under no necessity in this regard to say a word back to you. If it is to be, our God, whom we are serving with constancy, is able to rescue us out of the burning fiery furnace and out of your hand, O king. He will rescue us. But if not, let it become known to you, O king, that your gods are not the ones we are serving, and the image of gold that you have set up, we will not worship. Yay, Team God! And we're all familiar with the outcome and how it came to be praise, honor, and glory to the true God of the heavens even from the king himself, as he sent his decree throughout the land regarding it. Nebuchadnezzar was answering and saying, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and rescued his servants that trusted in him, and that changed the very word of the king, and gave over their bodies because they would not serve and would not worship any god at all except their own God. And from me, an order is being put through that any people, national, group, or language that says anything wrong against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego should be dismembered and their hands turned into a public privy. For as much as there does not exist another God that is able to deliver like this one." Praise, honor, and God, glory to the God Most High through the faithful conduct of these three Hebrew men. I want to imitate that faith. And the scripture is true. 1 Timothy 4:10. God is a deliverer of all sorts of people, especially faithful ones. So, here we have considered Jesus' apostles, Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego concerning law. How they were respected, trusted men with man, but God-fearing and faithful to God, regardless of man's law. Specifically, the apostles were faithful to their ministry in speaking truth, even when outlawed. Daniel was faithful to his worship of the Most High God when it was forbidden by man's law and resulting in death. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were faithful in God's law of not committing idolatry or worshiping, venerating, rendering sacred service to any other but God alone, even when the sentence was being pitched into a fiery, burning furnace alive. When the law of the land made these mandates in opposition to God's law, they obeyed God as ruler rather than men. In every instance of assault, threat, imprisonment, or death, may we be like these faithful people of God. And as we contemplate their conduct, let us be imitating their faith. Thank you so much for spending one of your greatest resources, your time with me, and considering these more important things, and for joining us this week for Toolbox Tuesday, Imitate Their Faith. I look forward to next week and the next tool brought to you in spirit and in truth. I truly hope you will tune in for it. Until then, may we be contemplating the conduct of faithful people and be imitating their faith. Signing off for now with agape and much, much Julia.